for all the council members who, okay, we're trickling in here. For all the council members, there's some water, there are water bottles back behind that dais there. If you need one. Well, I guess people are coming in here. Give them a couple more minutes. Okay, let's go ahead. I don't know why.
No, I'm fine. I'm fine.
Oh, okay. Okay. Do you have a PowerPoint?
I don't.
Okay.
The one page handout that I
got. Okay. Yeah, we can turn that light.
Favorite.
I'll do it.
I was thrown off here for a second. Yeah, well, they all
were.
I wasn't paying much attention. I did wonder why my stuff's got that tacky gun, but that doesn't look like it. Anyway, my wife will say I don't notice details very well. My wife would be correct about the details.
I want to welcome Representative Bentley here, and Senator Eddie Joe Williams popped in. We've had about 350 people watching online, so the live streaming is not, as I said earlier, just to check a box. We've had a lot of people who can't physically be here watching. And before we go to Barbara, do you have something you wanted to mention?
Yeah, I wanted
to hit your button there.
And they told me I was too close to the mic last time and it was jumbled, so I'm going to try to lean back a little bit. I wanted to correct a statement. I had said that our legislature had corrected the multiplication issue, and I got my bills mixed up. That was another state I was thinking of. We passed legislation to restore cursive.
That's right.
Not multiplication. So I apologize for that error. I was on the phone late at night with another state last night and got my states mixed up. So just wanted to correct that on the record.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Ms. Cox.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor, and thank you to the task force for providing me this opportunity to weigh in on the Common Core. I have some prepared remarks, and I just have a one-page handout, which you should have received. It has a chart at the bottom. Nothing goes viral like a bad Common Core math problem, something that takes a simple subtraction question and turns it into a multi-step process that confuses everyone over the age of 20. This was a beginning quote of an article by Nelson and Fong, and it caught my attention because it is really true that the Common Core state standards have been elevated to a level of conversation that usually isn't true about educational initiatives. What was interesting about the article was it went on and gave some facts and data about why that was true, and that also captured my attention. It mentioned the fact that American adults who are over 20 years of age, and as I look across this group, and across the room, I see most of us fit into that category. that we rank in mathematical problem solving at rank of 22 out of 24 countries. And that is based on traditional mathematic educational standards that we have implemented. Very few of us have experiences in solving mathematic problems in multiple ways, and that has directly led to the disconnect of parents assisting with homework. We are not used to using mathematical language. We are not used to talking about how we problem solve. In fact, most of us, as Karen said, we're taught mathematics in a very specific way, as a process, where you choose an application and you apply it to get the one right answer. This is very efficient and very effective, but I want you to reflect back on the math classes you took when you were in school during your educational career. This was really the basis of most of the math classes I took. In fact, for decades, the major emphasis in mathematics was on procedural knowledge. Rote learning was the norm, with little attention paid to understanding of mathematical concepts. Rote learning is not the answer in mathematics, especially if the student doesn't understand the mathematical concepts. Mathematics is more than arithmetic. It must include an understanding of how numbers work and can be utilized. It must provide students with the opportunity to think critically and to problem solve. I believe these are the skills we want to provide every student in our public schools. I agree that fluency and procedural fluency is a critical skill that every student should have, but the ability to solve problems, both basic mathematical problems and complex mathematical problems, are a goal that I also have for every student in Arkansas. When you learn math as a process, a series of steps that you go through to get a result, what happens when it doesn't work? And I want to give you some real life examples of how we have experienced a disconnect with mathematics in our lives. I am not a mathematics educator. And so part of my expertise that I'll be talking about and sharing with you today is how to support teachers as they build their expertise. The example I want to use, and I'm sure most of you will relate to it, is how many times have you interacted with a cashier and they have given you your change and you turn around and give them money back? This is something that I'm sure most of us have experienced. That is because that cashier does not have strategic competency, one of the mathematical standards. So let's be very practical in the example. Let's say that you stop and you make a purchase of $11.27 and you provide that cashier with a $20 bill and two pennies. Now, the reason you do that is you need quarters for the car wash. And so you've already calculated in your head the change that you would like back. You might receive a quizzical look and followed swiftly by the clerk's use of technology, meaning her cash register, to make the correct change while the entire time they're attempting to give you the two pennies back or to put them in the small container there at the desk because none of us really keep up with pennies anymore. Even worse in that encounter is not that they can't make the change, but what often happens is they'll be flustered, especially if you are like me and try to make it a teachable moment, and instead of putting in $20.02, they put in $200.02. Now, at this point in time, how many of you experience that they want to take away everything they've already rung up and start totally over? This is what's happened with the way that we have utilized mathematics to train Americans. It says something about the problem-solving skills of that specific cashier. Now, I'm not saying Common Core math standards will correct this, but if a individual has multiple ways to solve the problem and they understand math sense, they're going to know that they're giving you too much money before you have to start giving them bills back. That is one example. I believe mathematics instruction is not designed just to teach algebra, but to prepare students with math understanding leading to problem solving. Much of our discussion before lunch was on how it is a waste of time to generate multiple ways to reach an accurate answer. But as students are participating in CGI and other instructional strategies, they are practicing critical thinking skills, which will lead to them being able to apply that to real life problems. Common Core math attempts to build the student's understanding of how numbers are used to solve problems. I do agree that students should learn the usual process, the standard algorithm, because often it is the fastest way to solve math problems. But I also believe that there is value in allowing students to emphasize strategic competency where they can formulate, represent, and solve mathematical problems and be able to discuss that. One of the critical things about the Common Core is it does establish a language of mathematics. And so I'll ask you a challenge. When I was an assistant superintendent, I had a parent who was an engineer who told me, it doesn't really matter what you do as the school district in teaching algebra or algebra 2 to my student. Now, she ended up with a doctor, a dentist, and two engineers in her family out of our school district. But she explained to me that her father had a system of mathematical practices that he taught her and her siblings, who were all very successful, and she planned to teach those to her children. And so it didn't really matter what we provided them, because those mathematical practices were going to be the underpinning of math for her family. I suggested she write a book. I suggested she volunteer at the school and share some of those practices. She hasn't taken me up on it yet, but her family has been very successful. I challenge you to think about the last time you had a conversation with an educator or a family member in which you discussed mathematics and the language of mathematics. I'm sure the example you come up with is probably around budgeting or money, which is not the higher level mathematics that we're asking our students to develop skills in. I want to give you some examples of math training I went through. When I was in elementary school, the way we learned addition was we used manipulatives, we used flashcards. Should I ask how many people remember flashcards to build that rote memory? We spent several weeks on addition, all different types of addition. And then when the class had met the competency that the teacher had set, we then shifted gears and went to what? Subtraction. And what transition was made between addition and subtraction? I had an aha experience in mathematics, but it was not until I was in second grade when I had done hundreds of mathematical work pages. And that aha experience was when my math teacher showed me how I was making errors in subtraction and how I could use addition to check my work and make my problem solving much more accurate. I was never taught that addition and subtraction are inverse operations. That's something that within the Common Core math standards, often it's taught as an integrated unit, and so you understand both at the same time. So part of our discussion before lunch was how if there is a more efficient way, and we shouldn't spend our time on these collaborative-based math problems, I believe that there is real value in understanding deeper mathematical concepts, and that was a simple example I came up with. The Common Core attempts to assure that students move beyond rote memorization and learn how to do math processes and, even more importantly, apply those to real-life examples. Now, some of the work, most important work, I've done in my 41 years as an educator has been around the focus of my work for the last 4.5 years. At the Arkansas Public School Resource Center, we made a commitment to support teachers as they transition to the Common Core. And so I'm not here as a math expert, so the math questions can go to someone else. But I am here as a supporter of teachers as they make this transition. Much of the questions that I've heard this morning and in the past were around systematic implementation of the Common Core. Who gets what training? Why do they get specific training? What does that training look like? Teachers are the most important component in our full implementation of any educational change. That is why we have chosen to support their efforts to embark upon the challenging task associated with the Common Core and our next generation assessment. I want to share with you not the details of the 4.5 years of a strategic professional development plan, of modeling new instructional strategies besides CGI or any particular, but building the teacher's capacity to choose the correct instructional strategy based on her classroom and the needs of her students, or how we've curated resources to make sure that the critical need that teachers had for content materials could be addressed. But instead, I want to talk to you about how we have systematically documented the progress of Arkansas teachers. And so your handout is a set of data. That data was generated as part of our tracking system on changes in teachers' knowledge and practices utilizing the Common Core. They were done by an independent external evaluator, and each of the two sets of surveys included more than 1,000 Arkansas teachers. So what have Arkansas teachers been doing? You'll notice that I have pulled out from our much more comprehensive 62-page report the individual standards around mathematics. And so in 2013, teachers were emphasizing procedural fluency in math at a 68% level. They are now reporting in 2015 a 71% level of that as a focus, which was a small change. But when we do our next survey next year, I believe we'll have a larger change in that area. The second one is really about how teachers are creating instruction, and that's their instruction for implementation in their classroom. That doubled in a 2-year time period. And why did it double? Because they were unable to find already published high quality instructional practices, units of study. And so that has doubled in a 2-year time period. They self-reported rigorously pursuing math instructions for conceptual understanding. And that included finding outside resources to support their instruction. That raised 26% from 46% to 72%. And I won't go over each of them because I will allow you to ask questions later if there's one that captures your interest, but please look at the bottom two. In 2013, basically 2 years into Common Core, teachers recognized 90% of the respondents recognized that the Common Core would require a change in their teacher practice. And they were seeking assistance in changing that practice. But in 2015, out of the over 1,000 teachers, 99% of them said they had already implemented changes in their teacher practice based on the Common Core state standards. According to our surveys, our teachers in Arkansas understand that their classrooms and mathematics have to look different and that their practice was going to change. They will no longer stand in the front of the room and model a mathematical process and then assign practice of the next 50 items. But they are transitioning to becoming facilitators of learning that allows students to work together to solve real life problems. Teachers still teach students basic arithmetic, but the emphasis is on making sure that the students not only have fluency, but that they can understand the mathematical concept and apply it in a problem-solving way. Your role is critical, and why is it critical? Because we have hundreds of teachers across our state who have put in the time and effort to transition their practice because they believe in the Common Core state standards. Every single time there's a movement in the legislature or with your panel, I have teachers who contact me and who are expressing their concern that the time and energy they've put into this new practice of mathematics, they're afraid it's going to be done away with and that will be out of their control. This has almost become what one teacher described to me, a roller coaster ride. One day I'm up, the next day I'm down, and I'm trying to do my very best for my students. But I believe that today much of the focus has been on students and parents, and I'm challenging the task force that part of your focus needs to be to hear the voice of teachers. Teachers who have been implementing, teachers who are struggling to address many of the issues you've asked in your question. The Common Core has impacted, but one of the discussions earlier today was, is there a difference between the standards and the curriculum and the instruction, or are they tied together? And I'm paraphrasing you, Lieutenant Governor. I believe,
and I have an opinion on that.
I know, and so do I. I believe that when you talk to teachers who are working on implementation, the district may have, they understand what the standards are. They've read them, they have deconstructed them, and they are operationalizing it in their classroom. They understand that the district has provided them certain curricular tools. But who makes the decision about instructional strategies and the curriculum that will be used today at 2 o'clock in my classroom is that classroom teacher. And I believe their voice around the Common Core is a critical voice that needs to be added to this discussion. Arkansas has dedicated educators who have given of their time, their personal resources, and stretch their intellectual abilities to build a new design for mathematical instruction. Because at the heart of this entire discussion is what they believe in, which is that they can do a better job in providing the students of Arkansas an increased rigor in mathematics. It has been my honor to serve these teachers. And today, I would like to put their voice and their participation in this process as part of the discussion around the Common Core and Arkansas. Thank you very much for your attention, and we are welcoming any questions you might have.
Thank you for that. I want to, just because you mentioned my name, I just want to defend myself shortly. My mother's a teacher. We've heard from a lot of teachers. A lot of teachers would disagree about their ability to control how they teach. Some think that they have more power, more liberty. Some think they have none. There's a whole range. It's a very diverse group of people. When you talk about teachers, it's not a monolith by any means. The other thing I would say is the time and effort that people have put in is incredibly important, but I don't think anyone would ask us to continue on down a path just because we've put time and effort in it if we didn't believe it was the right path. Our test is not whether people have put time and effort in it. If you go down the wrong road, and you put a lot of time and effort in it, you're still on the wrong road. So the test for us is, what is the right path? If it aligns with the path we've already gone way down, that's going to be awesome. If it doesn't, that will be the governor's decision. No, we're just going to give our best advice. But we appreciate y'all coming. We started down there, so we're going to start down here this time. And, you know, we're not really paying attention to the rules still in terms of time, but I will just tell you what I think we're going to do, just so you get a, I think we'll probably go to an hour for the last panel, 4 to 5. We'll try, I'm sorry, 3 to 5, 2 hours, 3 to 5 for the last panel. So we're going to take 30 minutes away. So we'll probably go to right before 3 for this. So it's 15 till 2 right now. So let's try to keep it close to 5 as possible, and I'll be lenient as I have been. Go right ahead.
Okay, I would like to ask Ms. Armstrong a couple of questions about some of her information. We had the comment that CGI, of course, I had never heard of it. I'm a teacher until last week, okay? But I do not teach math, obviously. And so I wanted to ask you, is this something mainly for elementary? Because it was pointed out by our other speaker, our second speaker, that it should only go maybe to third grade. Is this something they're using past elementary, or is it basically an elementary concept that they're using?
CGI is pointed towards K through 3. There's a secondary program, not secondary, it's an intermediate math program that these authors have also done. It's called Extending Children's Mathematics, also called ECM, and that is for 4, 5, and 6.
Okay.
And there's research. Their research was right in line, and it's the same author group. The research has been taken place across the country.
Okay, well then I teach 8th and I'm in a standard junior high, so that would make sense that I've not really seen anything about it until last week when we started having our information. So, and obviously the teachers have to be very dedicated. You said 21 days for a 3-year program. And how did these teachers get to do this? Do they apply? Just in case someone in my district asked me, I would like to know, how do they get to do the CGI program?
In my district, our teachers are all expected to be trained. If you're going to teach math in the Bryant School District, you are expected to take CGI training and now ECM training for the older teachers. The educational co-ops all offer CGI, and then there are state trainers like myself around that different districts have them come in and do training within their buildings if they choose.
Okay, thank you. The other question I have was, and I don't know if any of y'all can answer, well, our speaker mentioned this, but I'm wondering if anyone can answer this. It said that we can add up to 15% to our Common Core standards, but they cannot be changed. We've heard this a couple of times today. Does anyone know if that is true or not?
Yes, that is true, and that is outlined in the Federal Register per our Race to the Top agreement, which was the mechanism through which we adopted Common Core. I have that documentation, and I can email that to the Lieutenant Governor if he would like to share that with the council, but we have submitted an FOI for that information. That is correct.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to clarify that. Okay, I will let it go on then.
I want to clarify, too, you raise a good issue here. So the states that are doing their own, I assume they are leaving the agreement. For example, Indiana's, I've heard that they're basically just calling it something else. So they would, how does that work? They would disengage completely, they would tear up the agreement they had, and then they would do their own thing. Is that how they get around that? How are they getting around that?
It depends on the state. My understanding is that the way to go about that is for the governor to submit a letter to the NGA and the CCSSO that essentially ends our memorandum of understanding with them with regard to the standards. What happened in Indiana was they ended up with a rebrand. So in Indiana, their legislature repealed, which isn't the best word, I would say more reversed, Common Core, and then they brought in a task force that was filled with pro-Common Core lobbyists who took the Common Core standards and rewrote them under another name. And when those standards were presented to members of the original validation committee, they found that they were, you know, 94-95% identical to what was in Common Core. So they got what I would call a bait and switch.
Okay. I want to go back to her. I was just trying to figure out how those other states got around that provision.
Yeah, you get out of the MOU.
Okay.
And I would also mention that there's already a structured procedure in our state that the Department of Education utilizes when they review curriculum frameworks, because we all know that the Common Core basically covers mathematics and English language arts, but there are existing curricular frameworks in every other content area, and the Department of Ed has a rigorous and structured process where teachers and representative content experts are chosen to represent the state to go through that process. So I would encourage, you know, an examination of what's already in place.
I just wanted to return, let her finish.
I am finished.
Oh, you are, okay, sorry.
Good afternoon. I worked with early childhood special ed students, 3 to 5. And one of the concerns, I was talking with some of the women I have worked with, and with the Common Core kindergarten standards, there's now becoming a gap between what we expect preschoolers to know and kindergartners to know. So many of these children are now being retained. What's your suggestion to fix this problem?
CGI research has also delved into the special ed population and have found it to be extremely positive for those children because it starts with a modeling. And a lot of times our special ed population doesn't get much beyond the modeling and counting. They don't get into the invented algorithms, but it's very successful for them to use. And I'm in our kindergartens a lot because that's not my knowledge area. I was an intermediate teacher. So I spend time in our kindergarten classes and I watch those, our developmentally handicapped children, and they are blossoming with those other children, because those teachers have an understanding of this child has got to model it concretely over and over and over before they understand it.
Is CGI training something you would recommend for the preschool teachers?
I have my special ed teachers all go through it. We haven't pulled our preschool teachers in yet, so I can't really answer that with a lot of authority. I would think it would not hurt them to go through it, because it's basically going to say this is how children think. And we heard this morning that kids come to school with innate math understanding, and that is so true. You can go into any kindergarten class the first or second week of school and you can do all 11 of these math problems, which I've done, and they're successful because they are allowed to model and make sense of the problem. And your developmentally handicapped children could do the very same thing, and so can your preschoolers.
I might also add that recently, because part of my background is special ed also, I did some training at one of the regional cooperatives where they brought in all their preschool staff to really look at an alignment that was vertically aligned from the current preschool standards to the Common Core standards for kindergarten. And in doing the research for that, there have been alignment documents in certain states, and if you email me, I'll send you that contact information. And in discussing with our preschool coordinator for the state, they have now received some funding in a recent federal grant where they're expanding preschool programs in specific counties in Arkansas. They now have some money to do that particular work. And so I suggest you also look for that, because there are going to be working committees who are addressing those issues.
Okay, thank you.
My answer to that is to replace Common Core with cognitively appropriate standards between kindergarten and three, and then you won't have that problem. There are a number of states that are now putting together pre-K Common Core aligned standards so that the preschoolers, when they get into kindergarten, are quote unquote ready. It's a very experimental process right now, and one that on a personal level as a parent, I disagree with. Because then, first it was kindergarten readiness, now it's pre-K readiness, and it's pre-K three readiness, and then it's gonna be pre-K two readiness, and before you know it, we're gonna be there with China where they're putting their kids in school at 1 year of age. And I just think that's a very dangerous slippery slope, and I think the easy answer is to replace Common Core at the elementary level with something that's cognitively appropriate and let four-year-olds be four-year-olds.
Can I respond back to that? Like I said, one of the first years that I taught in my position as a math instructor, my kindergarten teachers told me these CGI problems are not appropriate. Our kindergartners cannot do this. Well, I didn't know because I'd never taught kindergarten, and so I didn't want to act like a fool in front of my teachers at that school. So I went over to the school where my grandchild was a kindergartner, and this was the second or third week of school, and I said, can I come in as a grandparent and do an activity? So I went in and I read a book, gave those kids manipulatives, and we did every one of those 11 math types, and every single one of those children was successful in doing it because the numbers were that they could understand. It was a situation they could understand. These are appropriate for kindergarten.
Thank you.
When you say these.
These 11 problem types, okay, that are enumerated in Common Core. Common Core adds one extra one that is not in the original Carpenter research, mm-hmm, and it is the one that says, I have two add-ins unknown, which means I'm making bags of fruit and I can only use apples and oranges, and I put 10 pieces of fruit in every bag. How many apples might I use and how many oranges might I use? Your kindergartners can do that too.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I'm gonna let her finish. Go ahead.
I'm finished.
Okay. I have a pre-K in public, Little Rock Public School, and the best principal in the world is here on this panel. But that aside, I feel like a lot of times we're conflating Common Core, which is what this council's about, with CGI. I know you love CGI. I'm all for CGI, but that's not Common Core, and it is used, mm-hmm, in the implementation. And we had that discussion with our friend from California. That's where the curriculum becomes the standard, and vice versa. They get all mixed up in a bag. But it's technically not Common Core, and you can love one and hate the other, or vice versa, I guess. So I'm trying to make sure I understand what specifically we're talking about, because, and I'll just count this against my time, I guess. But I just got this a minute ago, and I'm not going to read all through it, but I would like for y'all, whoever's interested, to take a look at this letter, this joint statement. We've talked a lot about developmentally appropriate, and that's why I wanted to interject right now while we're talking about that. We've heard a lot about it. I still don't think we have a lot of answers on that. We've heard some opinions, but this is, and my child just turned five. And so if there's something that I ought to be concerned about, then I want to find out right now for personal reasons. Okay, so this is, we heard one person say, well, all the early childhood people were involved. My mom's been an early childhood teacher for 50 years, and she'd probably disagree with that. But we heard all the early childhood people were involved. And then we saw the Washington Post op-ed by some early childhood people that said almost no early childhood people were involved with Common Core, period. Then, so this is the Alliance for Childhood, on March 2nd, 2010, put out joint statement of early childhood health and education professionals on the Common Core Standards Initiative. The list is so long. There's even an Arkansan in here, Sarah McCormick Davis, associate professor, University of Arkansas, president-elect, National Association of Early Childhood Teacher Educators, Fort Smith. And I mean, like, I think every early childhood teacher in America is on here. And they basically say, we therefore call on the National Governors Association, the Council of Chief State School Officers, to suspend their current drafting of standards for children in kindergarten through grade three. We further call for the creation of a consortium of early childhood researchers, developmental psychologists, pediatricians, cognitive sciences, to develop comprehensive guidelines for effective early care and teaching that recognize the right of every child to a healthy start in life and a developmentally appropriate education. The standards will lead to long hours of instruction in literacy and math. They'll lead to inappropriate standardized testing. Didactic instruction and testing will crowd out other important areas. Little evidence such standards even help. Little evidence such standards for young children lead to later success. When I read this, I sort of get angry because it sounds like everybody's like, oh, no, it's just great. Just trust us. At best, there's a huge disagreement about all this. This is, to some extent, a big, depend on who you talk to last, deal. This is a big experiment. It's not like all the people with degrees and who have written papers agree with one side and everybody else is on the other side. So I'll get back to their question, but when it gets to me for the 30 seconds I have left, if I'd like your thoughts on when something like this comes out, does our Department of Education go, you know, they're fringe? Or do they go, this is serious stuff. We need to really take a look at what all these very well-meaning, educated, early childhood people are saying so that we're not doing something just because the whole crowd's doing it and because we worked so hard at it. And this really gives me concern. I mean, I haven't seen it. Yeah, I'm not a Common Core expert, so I just saw this today. But these are the type of things that when it gets to back to me, if y'all know about this, have you seen this? Have you seen this?
I have, and I would like to say that the Department of Ed has a Common Core website, and they do put articles that are for and against the Common Core at that site. How often an educator accesses those is up to the individual educator. I also know that there are other communication strategies that groups, networks of educators use to have an ongoing conversation. I do think that the issue about the developmental nature of Common Core, you know, these are not simple conversations. These are conversations that go to the values of the individual, individuals having the conversation. And much of the pushback is about not only the developmental nature, but how curriculum is being pushed down to earlier and earlier ages. And is it true that there are stages of development that make it significantly difficult for students to grasp concepts? That's why I think it's so critical that the conversations are research-based. Now,
these are,
I know,
pretty research-based folks.
And part of our presentations today, you know, are based in research on two different sides of the issue. I do believe that it's an issue around, do we send students to school only for education, or is there a broader definition of education, especially around early childhood? Because the definition of play, you know, is that an appropriate learning opportunity, and how does that translate into a standard? I think that's part of the discussion. And, you know, I think all of us would have, you know, our own opinions. I believe that play is an educational concept and that you're developing social skills, social, emotional, and heavily language. You know, that's where you practice language. That's where you take on different activities. So I would be more supportive because, you know, the Common Core was written by a group of experts that came together. Now, did they represent every subgroup in education? No, there may have been only one early childhood person. And we've heard today that there was some discussion when the documents were completed where every developer did not sign off. And so I think this is a perfect venue to have those kind of discussions.
Amen.
And I encourage you to look into those.
Okay. Thank you.
Can I?
Yes, ma'am.
You have in your packet that I gave you this piece of research, which is the study on kindergarten. And this is where the group, this particular group studied and started their research was with kindergarten students. That's where they came up with these problem types initially. And in this research, it talks about how successful the children were and the actual numbers. This research has been replicated over and over. And you'll notice.
And that's on CGI, not.
That's on problem types.
Okay,
and it's,
Okay.
This was before CGI was even developed. But you'll notice your list of authors on it, they're from all over the country. They're not just in one area. And this research has been replicated over and over. And is very, there's, you know, you can stand behind this research. And so the fact that they have found that the kids can do this, and, you know, you're going to go home to your child tonight, and you're going to say, how many chicken nuggets do you want? And is it a little girl?
Both.
Okay.
The pre-K is 5.
Okay. A boy or girl?
Boy.
Okay. So you're going to go home, and you're going to say to him, how many chicken nuggets do you want? And he's going to say, oh, I want 5. And you're going to say, okay, I gave you 2. Now how many more should I give you? And he can tell you.
He'll grab the bag.
He's going to say, I want 3, 4, 5. I need 3 more. And that's appropriate for him.
Totally agree with that.
And he's using a model. But, and that's a really hard problem.
Yeah, totally agree with that. And, you know, last time I checked, we were taught that way in the 70s. I remember that. I was. Word problems. Maybe it's because my mom's a teacher. I don't know. But this is not about Common Core. This is about problem solving, which can be tied to Common Core. I got all that. I'm all for problems.
All of these pieces are in Common Core. And
they can be.
I don't want you to throw the baby out with the bathwater.
Right. No, I'm don't worry.
And, you know, that's my whole purpose here is that we have worked on this and we have found this to be workable. And I'm concerned with where we're going.
Right. Here's the false choice. It is a false choice to say rote learning and or Common Core and problem solving. That is a false choice. There are lots of other ways to do more than rote learning outside of Common Core. That is a false choice. So, if you say to people, hey, memorize everything, and that's all you do, or Common Core and problem solving, well, of course people are gonna go, well, problem solving, Common Core. But that's not the choice before us. And that's what my friend from California was talking about. Look at the countries that perform and kick our tail. They're doing their own thing. And they got all kind of different ways of doing it. So I get it. I am trying to get at the heart of this. I don't care what every other state has done. I don't care what anybody else has done before me. I got 2 kids, and my responsibility is to make sure we are the best. And if every other state is going off a cliff doing something goofy, let them do it. If they're doing something great, which they rarely do in California, no offense, then let's follow them. But I made a pledge to learn this from ground zero. So when I see statements like this, instead of going, oh, I'm sure they've looked at this and I'm sure it's all fine, I'm gonna ask the questions and I'm just trying to get to the bottom of that. I'm sorry, I've taken up all my time for the rest of the day. Go ahead.
Well, good afternoon and thank you all for being here. I just wanted to ask, try to make it as simple as I can. Tell us how you would like to change Common Core, if you could, specifically, and tell me why you think we shouldn't, if you don't think we should. Give me some specific example. If we are really going to try and make our standards the best, whether it's Common Core or changing it up, let's hear from y'all.
I'll go first. I'll refer you back to my PowerPoint, which you have copies of the slides in your binder. And right at the very end, I think it's the second or third to the last slide, I give you a list of
as parents, what we have concluded we would change. From the top of my head, let me see what I can regurgitate quickly, and that was, we're not opposed to CGI. Some teachers love it, some hate it. Some parents love it, some hate it. I had CGI, and I was privately educated. I had it first through third, and remember it quite well. So we're not opposed to CGI, but we do think that CGI should be an option for the teacher in the classroom. We really want our teachers to just be able to do their jobs and do it with integrity without being told how to do it. So if a teacher or if a particular district wants to make the decision that they want to use CGI at the K through three level, we're fine with that. And it turns out that, you know, in order to execute Common Core at that level, CGI is very conducive to that. But we want the remaining constructivism pulled out of our standards. We want to get rid of the whole construct and argument piece of the math. We want to get rid of the drawing and explaining and all of the abstract processing, because our early childhood development professionals tell us that at the K through third level, they are not yet developmentally ready to abstractly process things. They need concrete operations. And so when you watch that video from Dr. Koshnick that I mentioned earlier, and Lieutenant Governor, you let me know if you want to do that today or if you just want them to watch it on their own. I have it in the queue there. She talks very specifically about how that is harmful to K through three students and what kind of consequences that has, and how she is personally seeing an increased number of patients in her office because of that. So we want to see those things taken out. We want the constructivism gone. We're indifferent to CGI. We would like to see the grade level proficiencies put back in, where by the end of third grade, you're expected to have your tables memorized and you're expected to be proficient from memory, not using manipulatives and all this other stuff, you know, by the end of fourth grade and division by fifth grade, that sort of thing. So anyway, you can refer back to that list. But we do have a very specific list of suggestions and things that we would like to see as parents and as teachers. I can't tell you how many teachers I've spoken to, not just here in the state of Arkansas, but around the country. I've interviewed over 300 teachers just in the effort to write my book. So, you know, we're speaking for both. And finally, one thing that I wanted to mention that's along those lines, when we're talking about what other states are doing, there's a group called the Fordham Institute that loves them some Common Core. They got a lot of money from Bill Gates to love it. And their job is to produce all kinds of research and study to back it up. And at the same time, they did a lot of front-end research to evaluate the existing state standards so that they could then crosswalk them to Common Core and make a decision as to which one was more superior, okay? And what they found was that, for instance, the state of Massachusetts was given a grade of far superior over Common Core. So their existing state standards were better than Common Core, which begs the question then, why did they jettison those standards and take Common Core? Massachusetts not only had the highest standards, but they outscored practically everybody in America and a good portion of our international competition on the PISA exam. Why aren't we looking at what Massachusetts was doing? They were on the right track and they have the results and the evidence to prove it. Why did they jettison those standards? Because they got over $700 million to do it. That's why. That's why. We can very easily create our own standards, and we don't have to reinvent the wheel to do it. There are other models out there. When I talk to people at American Principles Project about math, and I ask them, what math standards do you think are superior to Common Core? If we could model another state, what would you say? And they told me, California, 2006, were the best math standards in the country. Model those.
I just have got to clear up a couple of inaccuracies here. The Common Core now says in second grade that they will fluently add and subtract within 20, knowing all of their facts from memory in second grade. It says in 3087, fluently multiply and divide within 100, know from memory all products of two-digit numbers. Right here, right here, right here. That's right. They don't have to know their.
They don't have to know all 12. They only have to know two.
You're exactly right. And then in fourth grade, well, All right, you can have your agreement or disagreement. And then fourth grade, they are going to, by that time, use their standard algorithm. So we do have fluency built into Common Core. And then you ask how we would change it. There are very few standards that I could pick out and say I don't love. I probably, because I have taught for 35 years, think that most kids truly are not going to be fluent with multiplication and division by the end of third grade. I taught third grade and fourth grade for 18 years. Sometimes I'd have the same kids from third grade on into fourth grade, and they would look fluent coming out of third grade, but they weren't when I got them back in fourth grade because they just hadn't had enough experience. And so most children have not had enough multiplication and division experience to be fluent until fourth grade. It says third grade there, and we work towards that. But I personally believe, and I don't have research to back it up, this is just my opinion, I personally believe that's more appropriate for fourth grade. But that's a real minor thing. I am really pretty happy with everything else. I do know that children that are coming up with more sophisticated strategies always tie those back to their drawings and their models and their explanations. And if we don't have those, we are not going to have children that make sense of numbers as older kids.
I believe that we should take the opportunity to add, maybe not a total 15%, but I do think there are some areas that we could add standards which might address clarity and provide better opportunities. If you set me down and said, what would you personally add? I would depend on teachers who are the experts at their grade level with what's going on in the classroom. And teachers have spent a lot of time deconstructing the individual Common Core strategies and standards, and I believe they would have an opinion about what would be important at their grade level to have as additions. In terms of should we keep the standards, should we not keep the standards, my follow-up comment would be I would like us to really develop a systematic approach to implementation so that there aren't pockets of excellence where every teacher is trained in CGI, but there are opportunities that teachers who want to expand their skills are supported in expanding their skills and having an opinion about how the Common Core as a fourth grade math teacher needs to be changed. I think that would take a commitment of resources, time, but I think the benefit from that would help to address some of the strategic implementation missteps we've had. Part of the problem about Common Core is people don't believe they own it. Educators believe it was done to them, and who did it?
And amen, so, amen. That is, you've hit the nail on the head there.
And we could use that 15% to fuel a very powerful conversation that involved teachers and parents and other stakeholders, and I'm thinking higher ed, and really drive the conversation and help us get to a place where we can all embrace the set of standards, whatever they are.
Thank you.
I really appreciate that statement because I am a teacher. And as a teacher, I've been a teacher for 20 years. And it, the one thing that's so great about teachers is it doesn't really matter if you have Common Core standards or Arkansas State frameworks. If you're a good teacher, you're going to go above and beyond. So I believe whatever we develop, the teachers in this state, the great teachers in this state will do whatever they have to do. And the fact that you said that teachers need to have a voice is important to me as a teacher, and I appreciate that because so often we are left out of the conversation. But so I appreciate
can
that.
Can I make one quick comment?
Sure can.
I think not only should they have a voice, I think we should garner their opinion on what it is they need to put full implementation in place. And I believe if we have a real conversation with educators, they're going to express what their needs are. my experience in working with the districts that volunteer to be part of our Common Core initiative is we created a design team. And what we did year one was a systematic rollout. Everyone read the standards. Everyone learned what the shifts were. We modeled how that might look in the classroom. We talked about strategies, and we provided resources. But in year two, the teachers and the schools we were working with, they told us what they needed. And that is when they are empowered and they've made the standards their own.
I believe in order for it to be effective, whatever standards we have, teachers have to feel empowered in order to deliver them. And they do need to be, it needs to be flexible so that they can have their own creativity involved in that. To Ms. Armstrong, and I appreciate every one of you being here, in your professional opinion, because some districts don't, it's been brought out, some districts don't give their teachers an option. And you talked about that previously. And that is a concern for teachers. At least in my building, it has been a concern for teachers. In your professional opinion, is CGI a vital component in implementing Common Core math standards effectively? Or can you also suggest, you yourself, because you're an educator, other strategies along with CGI that could also be used to implement the standards?
I'm sure there's wonderful training out there available. CGI just is such a package. It works well, and it answers so many of the needs of the teachers because it gives them that in-depth math training. I know we talked this morning about, do we need to do a better job with preparing our teachers before they come out? And I had a teacher come to me last week after we finished a section of CGI 1, the first section, and she said, why wasn't I given this in my senior year of college? Why didn't I know this before I started teaching? Because it would have made my first 2 years easier. So, you know, there are some of those things that it probably needs to be part of our pre-service training. And Dr. Griffith has done some wonderful trainings with us that would have helped tremendously with Common Core implementation. So I'm sure there are other things out there. I just know CGI is a state initiative that Arkansas has bought into, and it answers a lot of the needs.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Good afternoon. Thank you all for being here. Like I said before, I'm learning a lot. This question is directed toward Ms. Lamoreaux. The not so new math, that was really interesting to me, that it was done in the 1920s, 1954, 1960s, 1990 through 2006. It goes back to my question of how long are we gonna do this before we figure out if it's working or not and how well it's working. This kind of answered my question, but my question is, what can you show to prove that this Common Core is what this is talking about? This was what was in the 1920s. Is it the same thing?
I don't have to show it. The authors of Common Core have acknowledged that the standards are written by a group called Achieve, Inc. They are a DC beast. DC beast. That was an intentional slip, I'm sure. They are a DC-based trade group that was created essentially for this purpose. And they were asked, is there constructivism in the standards? And they acknowledged, yes, there was. They took the latest version of the constructivist standards that was released, which was called Focal Points, and that dates back to 2006, and they crosswalked it to Common Core, and they found that they were identical, nearly identical, I think was their wording. So the authors of Common Core have acknowledged that what we are dealing with is constructivism. And the early childhood education community has acknowledged that they were not part of the validation committee. They may have been part of the early stages of reviewing or authoring standards, but they were not represented on the validation committee. And they are telling us that from a child development and psychology perspective, constructivism simply doesn't work for the majority of the kids that are in K through three.
And can I jump in?
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, whether you use CGI or not is indifferent. CGI is not the problem. I'll admit, when I first entered into this journey, if you go to my website and you look at my interviews with Fox News a year and a half ago and hear what I was saying, I really thought CGI was the bad guy. After 2 years of research, what I have found is that of all the constructivist approaches that are out there, CGI is probably the least offensive to me. And CGI is not the issue. The issue is the abstract processing that is called for in the standards, and that is constructivism. When you ask these children to process things in an abstract reasoning way, to construct viable arguments, and then the drawing and illustrating of concepts that at that age they're not equipped to do. And this is why parents are dealing with crying children at night. You know, you hear teachers say, oh, it's going great in the classroom. We've got our manipulatives and we're drawing our circles and squares. And you hear these victories from these paid groups that say, oh, this is working great and these kids are doing things we never thought they'd be able to do. Well, that's because mom's up for 3 hours every night at the kitchen table with a crying, kicking, screaming child trying to figure this out. So what's happening in the classroom is very different than what's happening at home. Learning should not be that kind of struggle. This set of standards, particularly for the babies, for the elementary school kids, is going to kill their love of learning. And you're going to see the exact same thing that you saw in the 1950s, where we have fewer and fewer children even taking these Algebra 1 classes because, A, they're not going to be prepared for them, and, B, they're going to hate math by the time they get there. That's what history has taught us four times since 1920.
May I add just a couple of comments? It is true that Achieve is a nonprofit, that part of their operating staff were part of the Common Core creation. But there were other groups that were also involved, including Student Achievement Partners. Three of the lead writers of the Common Core State Standards then created that nonprofit. And early into the Common Core discussion, we had those members of Student Achievement Partners come into the state to provide information on how the standards were created. And so there were several nonprofits that have grown out of the process. Achieve really has worked much more on publicizing the standards than being that intimately involved in the creation of them.
If I may expand on that, Student Achievement Partners came before Achieve, but they were led by the same guy, David Coleman, and they were hired specifically to write these standards. So it's semantics. Student Achievement Partners, Achieve, it's the same group. Same group of people. And they were hired by the NGA and the CCSSO to develop the standards, and they gave the copyright to the NGA and the CCSSO. That's who holds the copyright now. They are also DC-based trade lobby groups. They own the copyright. Now, technically, if we take those standards and we change the name and we add 15%, could be copyright infringement. Now they're saying they're not going to pursue that now because they're so desperate to keep their product going. But they call it a living document. They've already made changes to language in the standards and in the supporting documentation online. It is their living document, not ours. We need a set of standards that belongs to us that we can change at will when we decide that something is or isn't working for our students. If you think getting something done at a city council level is hard, or getting something done at a state level is hard, or getting something done at a federal level is hard, try getting something revised with two unaccountable DC trade groups who, they're not accountable to you, they don't have to do what you ask them to do as a state, and how long will it take for them to make those changes? We need to be able to make changes on our time in our state.
Ms. Cox, did you have one more thing?
I was just going to say, currently, David Coleman is no longer associated with either of those nonprofits. He now is the CEO of College Board, and College Board has a long history of academic rigor.
Okay. Thank you. I do have another question on the, I think you said Euclidean versus transformational. Can you kind of elaborate? And it's open to all three of you.
I would rather defer to Mr. Werman on that one. He's really the expert on that. And we talked a little bit more about it at lunch. I will just say that my research has taken me to the point of understanding that there is transformational geometry in the Common Core standards, and that is considered a constructivist approach, and that it has failed in other countries where it has been tried. But I think Dr. Werman could provide you with more research and explanation on that better than I could.
I'm an elementary teacher, so I don't really get into the Euclidean geometry, but I have been informed that it is geometry in a plane. And all of the transformations are transformations in a plane. So transformational geometry is a part of Euclidean geometry. High school people, help me out, is that correct? Okay, so just to be accurate, there's not a difference between the two.
Okay. That's it, thank you.
Our former witness is holding up his hand.
Now he had his turn.
Yeah. Just tell us, is it the same or not?
Very briefly, we keep teaching Euclidean geometry in the previous standards, in the current Common Core standard, no problem. The question is how we justify, how we prove things. The Common Core promotes a particular way using rigid transformations that has that is possible to be done, but requires very high level of mathematics. This approach is done in colleges in mass majors. It was tried in Soviet Union for school for gifted students and failed miserably because neither the students and no regular teachers could handle it. And this is what is promoted as an exclusive, explicit dictate by the Common Core. It's basically an experiment.
Gotcha. Do you want to discuss Euclidean geometry more? Okay.
Could do a better job.
Okay. Go right ahead. Whoever's next.
Let's see. Where do I start? It seems from what I'm hearing a little bit of conflicts about some think that Common Core's too hard. Some think the standards are not rigorous enough. And I'm getting a little muddy, which doesn't take much for me, but it almost appears like lower grades are what you're more concerned with, and the upper grades were more what Dr. Werman was concerned with. I'm from a high school standpoint, and so I'm not familiar with a lot of the elementary Common Core standards or, you know, what's appropriate where. The CGI, I believe, is all elementary. Miss Armstrong, what curriculum do you think is best for high school?
Oh, you're asking me to talk about something I can't even talk towards.
I didn't know if you were the curriculum for the entire district.
Just am K-5.
Okay. We have done some, or our district has done some research, and we have, a lot of our high school math teachers have been to the LTF training. Are you familiar with that? And also we're looking at, or actually we are starting to look at Engage New York. Are any of you familiar with Engage New York at all, and could you comment on that?
You want to talk, Barbara? You want me to?
You can.
We have looked for the past 2 years for a textbook because we have teachers and parents that are asking for resources. And when we looked last year, we looked at all the top things, and we found one online program that we thought sort of matched up with Common Core. Well, the teachers were not happy with it during this past year, so we looked again this year, and ultimately we've gone with Eureka Math, which is the people that wrote Engage New York. And I can't tell you that it's the perfect solution, but there are some pieces that are really good, and it is written for Common Core. I don't know what it looks like in upper grades. They do have an intermediate part and a primary part, and they even have a preschool part. We didn't look at the preschool part, but it has some good pieces to it. It has some parts I'm concerned with, but you know, nothing is going to totally please me.
Right.
I know quite a bit about Engage New York. It's one of the mathematical curriculums that has been utilized across our network. And I think that it's a great beginning. I think that one of the concerns I have is that because they've grown so quickly and have transitioned to expeditionary math and now it's called Great Minds, I think that what is missing is a strong professional development piece because it is comprehensive and it is rigorous. And it can be a little overwhelming when you're used to not a standards-based mathematic curriculum. And much of the training we've done is with teachers on what to utilize and what's the essence of the curriculum across the board to make sure that they're covering all the components of the Common Core. We just recently had an opportunity where we sent a series of our instructional coaches that provide direct classroom services to our network of schools to a 5-day comprehensive training around the instructional strategies with Engage New York. And we're going to be hosting some regional trainings to offer that across the state for interested districts. In the last 2 years, I've seen many more school districts look at that for an option, and I know that the final panel of the day has a teacher representative that has been utilizing that curriculum, so you might want to kind of save that question.
Okay. Stay as far away from New York Engage as you possibly can. New York Engage was the Common Core curriculum that was directly funded by Bill Gates and was originally supposed to come out of a company called Common Core Inc. in 2007 until they figured out that they were breaking federal law by doing that, so they ditched it and rebranded it and called it something else. And that's Engage New York. Engage New York was piloted in New York, and it was an absolute disaster, and they're ditching it. Parents raised hell like you would not believe over that math. It is about as constructivist as you can get. And the thing you have to understand when you ask a question like that is that as long as you are operating within the limits of the Common Core state standards, any curriculum that is aligned is going to walk and talk pretty much the same. It's either abstract constructivist or it's not. Doesn't matter who publishes it. Take Saxon, for example. Saxon math has been around for a long time. Very popular among private schools and homeschools. Has been here forever. They have two versions. They have their regular math, and they have a Common Core math book. You can choose which curriculum you want to buy. That's how different they are. Anything aligned to the Common Core is going to be abstract, constructivist in nature, and it's going to leave our kids up to 2 years behind before the seventh grade. With regard to Eureka, Eureka math was such a failure in St. Tammany Parish, Louisiana. And St. Tammany Parish was the leading parish in Louisiana with education. They were the highest performers there. They have a huge reputation. Parents will specifically buy a house in St. Tammany so their kids can go to school there. Eureka Math has been such a mess that their school board in St. Tammany Parish wrote up a resolution and voted unanimously against it, and they are taking it out of St. Tammany schools. So, you know, when things like this happen, sometimes it's good that we're in Arkansas and we're always kind of behind the eight ball and last to get on the train because we can see where other people have gone. And we can learn from their lessons. You guys need to be talking to people in other states. You need to be talking to New York, New Jersey, Kentucky, California, Florida, because we can learn from where they've been. New York and Kentucky are significantly further ahead of us, almost a year ahead of us in this process. And so we can learn a lot from what's happened there. And I encourage you to network with them. But I would stay away from Eureka, stay away from New York Engage, and stay away from GoMath, stay away from Turk investigations. Those are the ones that are wreaking the most havoc on math as far as parents and students are concerned. Yeah.
Just a little follow-up. One of the things, Ms. Lamoureux, that you mentioned was, well, with the constructivism, of course, the drawing and the abstract thinking. You know, me coming from a high school standpoint, drawing and abstract thinking is absolutely critical to my trigonometry students when they're trying to talk about the navigation of a some sort of an aircraft, and so they have to draw it and the like. So it kind of appeals to me for the younger kids to get a little taste of it so that they can have a pictorial view of what's going on. But now, like I say, I'm not familiar with anything in elementary in terms of, I have a couple of grandsons, but they are in private schools, but I do believe they use Common Core somewhat. But there was one thing that that I missed on a discussion about the two-digit versus, and I totally missed what that was, and I
3087 says that they'll fluently multiply and divide within 100 and know from memory the products of 2 1-digit numbers. Now she is of the opinion, I think, don't let me put words in your mouth,
Is
of the opinion that since we don't also ask them to memorize the 11s and the 12s,
okay,
that she's
okay,
not counting them fluent.
Okay.
There is another standard, and I don't have it written down right here, that happens in second grade where they're working with groups of 10, so the fluency of the 10 facts has already been taken care of. So we are lacking the 11s and 12s to make Karen happy.
In what grade?
By third grade.
Okay.
So
I understand now. I just
exactly.
I didn't understand.
You know, when I talk to parents and students and teachers and research in my book about abstract processing and constructivism, one of the lessons I learned along the way was from adults my age who had to have math remediation in college, because algebra just wasn't their thing. And they said to me, you know, the constructivist math was really helpful to me in college. And so going down my research, what I found is that absolutely makes sense. When you read the 2008 National Math Advisory Panel report that was ordered by Bush during No Child Left Behind, what you'll find is that one of the observations they made in that report is that it's not that constructivism is bad in math, it's just bad at the elementary level. Constructivism works best on older, more adult-like students. So at the high school level, constructivism can be very helpful. At the college level, constructivism can be very helpful because those people have grown past and out of their concrete thinking stage of development. But to force that on elementary school students is asking them to do something they're not yet wired to do. And so that's the difference, and that's why we make the recommendation that we pull the constructivism out for seventh grade and below. Eighth grade and above, we don't have a problem with it.
Can I just mention one tool? There's a recent group called edreports.org, and they're an independent group that has reviewed educational materials, and they have free reviews on materials that are aligned to the Common Core, and also they define other indicators of high quality that as recommended by educators, and I couldn't remember their name, but their web address is just edreports.org. So you might want to spend some time looking at their evaluation. They have, they're an independent group that looks at the content of math curriculums.
I'm not really sure I have any questions, but someone at some time, whether it's y'all or not, I need this cognitive appropriateness and the abstract thought and the development of a 6 through 9 year olds to have those details and get that meshed up psychologically and compare these, because that's a repeated, before I even, Governor Hutchinson was even in office, I heard this concern with parents and teachers, pro and con. And, you know, having children with learning differences, anything like this that isn't, you know, I understand cognitive ability, and we need to get that settled.
I'm gonna
you know,
for you on that.
Just settled how these standards do, you know, fit up medically, developmentally, neurologically with the ages and everything, and just, you know, take care of that.
But, and that's, you know, the kindergarten research that I gave you starts that journey for you.
Yeah, and I've...
And we frequently host groups of our grade level teachers. In fact, we just hosted the kindergarten group from across our district, and we're a fairly large district. And they were discussing how they wanted to change their pacing and report card for next year. And they were talking about that just assessing with these children with numbers up to 10 was just not challenging enough. And I said, okay, now guys, 5 years ago, you told me your kids couldn't do any of these problems. And I said, so what has changed? And they said, we've had higher expectations. That's what Common Core has given us, is higher expectations, and it lets our kids move up. You know, Common Core is a floor for everybody to stand on. It is not a ceiling to keep anybody down. And so the fact that my kindergarten teachers feel like 10 is not a big enough number for those kids to work is a huge celebration for me. And so I think you're going to have to go out and look at what is happening in your child's life as to what's developmentally appropriate for your child, but yeah, have high expectations.
I know I was a elementary school student in the 70s, and when we did the math, I remember my parents, some of the same comments that are being made now were being made when I was in second grade. And I specifically remember second grade because I had a man for a teacher, and he was a new hire. That school had never had a man for, you know, elementary school. And I remember doing multiplication at the end of second grade. And we did our math facts, but it was combined with. Mm-hmm. It was kind of similar to Common Core, yet different.
Mm-hmm.
And so I know that a 7-8-year-old, mainly 8-year-old by the end of seventh grade or second grade, can do a lot more than what we have been having ours do.
And you heard one of your council members talk about how his kindergartner came home and did a division problem that ended up with a fractional answer,
and
was not a problem with that.
We didn't have kindergarten. That may actually make some difference, because by the age of 6, what they're learning in kindergarten, we learned in the first 6 weeks of first grade. We were a little more mature. That could be debatable whether it's a good thing or bad thing, but I know that I have the college freshman and the high school senior, and I know what they did in elementary school was well below what their abilities were.
You know, this brings me back to a comment that Dr. Griffith made earlier about having balance. And I agree with her on that. I think we need balance. As parents, when we complain about the approaches to Common Core math, it's not that we're adverse to giving children multiple ways of solving a problem. I am all for empowering our children with multiple approaches and multiple ways. The more tools they have in their toolbox, the better. I've got two kids who learn completely differently, and they have two different personalities. They do things differently. So that resonates with me. We're not opposed to giving them multiple approaches. What we are opposed to is trying to force on them approaches that they're not wired to do, in lieu of another alternative. And that's the problem that we're running into with Common Core, because Common Core does dictate the pedagogy. And so the teacher has to go about it in an abstract, constructivist way. And then when you are tied into a Common Core-aligned test consortium like PARC or Smarter Balance, you can look at the practice test questions and see that the test expects the child to use the abstract, constructivist approach, or they do not get full credit. That's not balanced to me. If an abstract approach works for a child, great, teach it to them, and if they want to solve the problem that way, that's fine. But if my oldest can solve it with standard algorithm and do it in her head, she shouldn't be penalized for it. And she shouldn't be forced to learn it the other way if she's already got a strategy that works. That's what we're running into, and that's why we need to have our own set of standards that aren't dictated by outside sources, so that we can achieve the balance I think everybody wants to have.
And there is nothing in Common Core that says a child cannot use a standard algorithm before fourth grade. It says it's not in the test. It's in the test they can solve it, and it never says, show me your standard algorithm or show me your drawing, because it's all on the computer. So there is no way that they can show a drawing or show the standard algorithm. They're doing it in an equation. And an equation is different from a standard algorithm.
That's simply not true. And to prove that, I would encourage you to go to parkonline.org, take the math practice test for third and fourth grade. Go take the math practice for third and fourth grade and tell me if it allows you to get full credit using standard algorithm or if you have to use your mouse and click on a bunch of boxes to get the answer. Okay. And if you've got to use all those graphics, you are looking at constructivism.
Okay.
And I would also encourage you to go to Smarter Balance, the other national testing consortium, and look at the test design of those items also in math and English language arts. There's a practice test for each of the grade levels.
Okay.
Thank you.
Don't go to the Smarter Balance test, though, because that's bad, too.
I pulled up a Washington Post op-ed to going to the issue of developmentally appropriate. We have talked a lot about that. We talked a lot about it at the first hearing. We've heard it thrown around a lot. Having listened to the first panel, having listened to this panel, I think what I'm concluding is there is a clear line, particularly on math, K through three versus the other. I mentioned earlier this joint statement of every early childhood teacher in the country on here. To your point, though, now that you mentioned it, in this op-ed in the Washington Post, written by some early childhood experts, this is what I think goes to the developmentally appropriate component. It's not about hard. There are some people that don't want hard things. That's not me. I want it really hard. I want it probably harder than anybody else wants it. But I also want it developmentally appropriate. There are two different things. You want to make sure something's developmentally appropriate, and then once you've passed that hurdle, then you can determine how hard you want to make it or how high you want the standards to be or whatever. I will tell you that, and I'm really concerned about this because both of my kids fit in this K through three segment. And they talk here about, and I mentioned a little bit of this before, they reference this particular op-ed references the joint statement that I read earlier. But here's what they say. They say that the National Association for the Education of Young Children is the foremost professional. And by the way, my mom's been early childhood for almost 50 years, won award for best teacher, Southern Association for Children Under 6 years ago. So I hear secondhand a lot about this. The National Association for the Education of Young Children is the foremost professional organization for early education in the United States, period. Yet it had no role in the creation of the K through three core standards. The joint statement opposing the standards was signed by three past presidents of this group and by Dorothy Jerome Singer, the Yale University Child Study Center, you name it, Harvard, you name it. And it goes on to basically say, it's not about hard in this context, it's about what's appropriate. The stakes are enormous. Dr. Carla Horwitz, the Yale Child Study Center, notes that many of our most experienced and gifted teachers of young children are giving up in despair. Quote, they are leaving the profession, end quote, because they can no longer do what they know will ensure learning and growth in the broadest, deepest way. The core standards will cause suffering, not learning, for many, many young children. Now, that's not because it's hard. That's because it's not, in their view, it's not because it's hard. These are Yale and Harvard. They're used to hard stuff, I'm sure. It's because they don't think it's developmentally appropriate. And they say, and there's a lot of specifics here, but one of the things they say is didactic instruction and testing will crowd out other crucial areas of young children's learning, active hands-on exploration and developing social, emotional problem-solving and self-regulation skills, all of which are difficult to standardize or measure, but are the essential building blocks for academic and social accomplishment and responsible citizenship. I don't have the answers to this today, but I want to raise this for the panel. because from a personal standpoint as well as the official standpoint, there may be great answers to this here in Arkansas, but I'm going to dig really, really deeply and find out whether this was. Now, I can tell you in the case of the standards Common Core, this was all brushed under the rug. Because it says here, we know that the instigators of the standards at the NGA and Council of Chief State School Officers were aware of the joint statement. Copies of it were hand-delivered, et cetera, et cetera. We called the heads, along with several others, asked them a comment. None of them returned our calls. So I want to find out whether this is a much ado about nothing or not. And I'm happy to go on that journey with you. I don't want to ask any questions, but if you, but
yeah,
go ahead.
When you go to do that, and I know you guys have got access to the progression.
And I do have it, yes.
Yeah. And if you'll note, when it talks about the different problem types, it notates that only these problem types are appropriate for kindergarten to be assessed. It doesn't say you don't want to introduce the others, but these are the only ones they feel like kindergartners should be assessed. So do keep
under
that in
Common
mind.
Core, right?
It is in under Common Core.
So you would believe, and I'm not putting words in your mouth. You would believe that either the people that wrote this did not see that.
Well, this came out after Common Core was released.
Okay.
So it's very
okay.
possible
so it could
they
be.
Wrote that before
okay.
they saw this.
I'm not going to take up any more time, but that's something I really want to dig into because it's important. And the answer may be not much ado about nothing. But I'm going to find out.
May I send you
may send me anything you want.
The National Institute on Early Childhood Research.
Yes, you can send me anything you want.
There are evidently two different, very different groups here. I just want you to see both sides.
Sure, sure. Okay, sounds great. And we take whatever you want to send us. Yes, sir.
Good afternoon. I do want to point out I took a class in college called Non-Euclidean Geometry. I would need Mr. Werman's help at this
Did
point.
Did Governor Hutchinson know that when he put you on this panel?
I kept that hidden. That was deep down in the resume. Ms. Lamoreaux, you've made some bold statements today, and I appreciate your passion and your your forthrightness, outspokenness. I'm just a couple things, three or four things I want to run down, and if you could give me some brief. I'm respectfully, I don't want to say challenging, but looking for some maybe some backup or some facts, or and I'm just going to go down the list. National Council of Teachers of Mathematics is a social reform group. Park, you lose points if you don't use a constructive. Well, you kind of talked about that on a computer-based test. There's a link between Common Core and attention deficit disorder and behavior problems. Lockstep. Dictated pedagogy when it's not, I mean, per my understanding, districts and schools, and the principal, my school, districts and schools dictate pedagogy. There's a race to the top agreement that you said that we signed on to with Common Core. My understanding was that we applied for a grant and it was denied. And then the other part about it'll leave our kids 2 years behind. So these are all statements that you've made. Where would you like to start?
Let's start from the beginning.
Okay. National Council of Teachers of Mathematics.
National Council of Teachers of Mathematics. I encourage you to do a lot of research about them online. They've been around for a very long time, and they've
I was a member for
reforming.
A long time.
Okay. Yeah. And so they've been reforming education a lot. And the handout that is included in your binder that I think it's like 38 pages long, history of the math. That goes in depth into that. I thought he did a really good job. And I have more on that in my book and the sources in the back that you can read. But in essence, when you go back to when they were first founded, 1920s, 1930s, the National Council of the Teachers of Mathematics takes a very controversial look at education. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I'm saying it's very controversial, and not everybody agrees with it. And at the end of the day, they made sure that their focal points standards, which are constructivist math standards, were included as part of the Common Core, and that was confirmed by Achieve Inc., along with others. There's
Dr. J.P. Green here in Arkansas, who released a blog about that. So they should just come out and admit that Common Core is constructivist, among others, like the Pioneer Institute, American Principles Project, and so on. So, you know, really an opinion about the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics isn't critical here. You may love them, I may not, right? But the bottom line is that those constructivist math standards do come from them, and that is exactly what is in the Common Core. What was the second one?
Real quickly, we will, Jay Green is University of Arkansas. He'll be testifying, and so I'll ask him directly.
Okay, what was the second one?
The second one was the lose points if you don't give a constructivist answer on the part. But if you're okay, we'll just skip over that one because you
That's fine, and that's what some of the insiders, whose names I can't reveal because they'll get in trouble, some of the teacher testing coordinator folks and high school students are reporting to us after they take the test.
And by the way, this whole discussion, I'm going back to my philosophies of education and my PhD in constructivism.
Yes.
And my understanding was a little bit of a broader definition in that we learn by, we kind of build our own building blocks and what we learn. And and so I think you're taking that definition. And it may not be just you. I understand.
There's some Piaget in there. And I could tell you who could expand on that more is Dr. Sandra Stotsky. She's an expert on Piaget. And I attended a forum that she spoke at a year or so ago where the whole topic of the conversation was Piaget and Common Core. So if that's something that interests you, I'd encourage you to look up her white papers.
That's kind of a little bit French, though. can you speak to the link between Common Core and attention deficit?
Okay. There's not a definite link. What my statement was is that we are observing an increase, according to members of the early childhood development community, there is an increase in the last few years in the diagnoses of attention deficit disorder and an increase in behavioral problems and anxiety and things like that. Now, do we have hardcore solid research to connect those dots yet? No, it's too early to do that.
A possible correlation.
I think there's a possible correlation. I think that's a good way to put it. That's definitely what I saw in my child. And I also think it's important, you know, I have kind of a personal bias against Pearson education. I would classify them as the root of all evil in education. I can't stand them. And one of the things that bothers me about Pearson is that they also own an ADHD test. And they have been pushing to get some of those elements and those psychometrics built into their PARC test. Psychometrics is going to be all the rage here in standardized testing as we move forward. But that's one of the other reasons why, as a parent, I really get itchy about Pearson education.
The next one was the comment about Common Core dictating pedagogy down in the classroom level.
Yes. And that was mentioned on the earlier panel, right, when Dr. Warman was up here and he talked about how in some of the standards, not all, but in some of the standards, the pedagogy is there and tells them explicitly how to do it. So instead of just saying the child has to master this particular thing, it goes on to tell them how they have to master it. And we see that in the test. We see that in the practice questions of the PARC test. So to me, that's not balance. You know, if we want to give the kids multiple ways to problem solve, I think that's great. But at the end of the day, they should be able to do it however it works for them. Are you going to have some abstract thinkers in your class at an early age? You probably will. And if that works for them, great. I've talked to some parents of kids with autism in my business. I own a swim school, and we deal with a lot of special needs kids. So I have a lot of interaction with the special needs community. And they're always bending my ear about Common Core and how it's impacting their children, mostly in a negative way. But one of the things they disagree with me on is the math. Because for some reason, it turns out that they're starting to see this very unofficial trend among the kids who have autism being able to think abstractly. And so those methods are working for some of those kids, but not for the neurotypical kids. So let's put them all out there and have balance and let the teachers decide what works best for their kids in their classroom.
Right. And we've had previous panel members who have said just that the Common Core allows districts and schools and teachers to use the pedagogy they deem appropriate for.
Depending on what standard they're executing, yes. And you can choose whatever curriculum you want. You can, depending on whether or not your district mandates it. Like in Bryant, you don't have a choice, right? You've got to do CGI. But, you know, depending on what school district you're in, you can choose a curriculum. In other words,
if I'm a fifth grade teacher teaching math, and my district says, you're the teacher, you pick whatever curriculum you want, I can choose Saxon, I can choose Eureka, I can choose Go Math, I can choose CGI, which I wouldn't do in the fifth grade, I could choose Turk Investigations, whatever, but the bottom line is at the end of the day, anything that's aligned to the Common Core is gonna do the same thing. Because they're aligned to those standards, and those standards drive how the curriculum is written. That's why all of the publishers had to rewrite all of their books and all of their software and then put that stamp on the front that says now aligned to the Common Core. But you can go out there and find the complete opposite that's not aligned.
And just one more time, CGI is not a curriculum. It is a training for the teachers so that they can find where the child is, and then they can set a goal and help them move on. But it's not a curriculum that says, today you're going to do this, tomorrow you're going to do this. I'm going to check you on personal assessments on a regular basis, and I'm going to move you because I understand the continuum.
And that's great. And like I said, we don't have a problem with CGI at K through 3 level. I learned it. I thought it was great. When you get into the older grades, anything that's aligned to Common Core is going to use those abstract constructivist methods, and that's what's wreaking havoc. And those methods are clearly outlined in the standards for mathematical practice. That's where the problem is.
I'm gonna skip over the race to the top, and I'll check on that one myself.
The race to the top. Agree. I'll give you a quick answer. Quick answer.
He's gonna buzz me.
Time. Everybody had to apply, but it was a binding agreement whether you got the grant or not. And in the proposal, you had to agree to set up a state fiscal stabilization fund account. And any state that did not get the race to the top grant got state fiscal stabilization money instead. I have copies of those contracts and those proposals. You can see that they are binding. You can see that we took $364 million out of the same stimulus fund as race to the top to execute this. So all of that is semantics.
Okay. And then finally, I'm sorry, I'm going over. You made the assertion or the statement that it will leave our kids 2 years behind. And then you mentioned, look at Kentucky. Yes. And Kentucky has shown on ACT and SAT shown small gains.
Okay.
Small gains. And we're early in the process. Everybody
sure.
agrees we're early in the process. But they've been doing it for 5 years,
mm-hmm.
4 or 5 years. So certainly those high school students have been in Common Core probably 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th.
Not true. Common
They've
Core did not roll out to the high school students until the 2012 school year. It went K through 2 in the 11, I'm sorry, in the, let's see, it was adopted in 2010. So it would have been 10, 11 school year. I may be off by a year,
so
but
a
it was K
of,
through
so
2, 3 through 8, then 9 through 12. So just like here in Arkansas, the high schoolers have only had Common Core for 1 year, and Kentucky was the first state to get out of the PARC consortium, and that's important to note. As far as the 1 to 2 years behind, that's not my conclusion. That is the conclusion of the American Principles Project and the Pioneer Institute.
And the stair-stepping of Common Core K2, 3, 8, 9, 12 was a decision that Arkansas made. Other states did implementation with different blocks of grades or all the grades at the same time. So you'd have to research what occurred in Kentucky as part of their rollout.
Thank you.
Okay. On your, Ms. Cox, on your chart here,
yes.
Where were your 1,000 teachers from?
They were from all over the state. We publicized it in a newsletter, and I have a breakdown of which districts, because they marked their district, so we could make sure there was geographic distribution.
Mm-hmm. That's what I was wanting to know, is if we just got all Bryant, because it seems like we have a whole lot of people here from Bryant or associated with Bryant School. So I can see that they had a success in rolling out Common Core. But our other small districts have not been so successful. So all the praises for Common Core that I've heard have come basically from surrounding school districts of that. What I'm concerned about are the outline, the rural, the poor districts, the schools with poor kids, with ESLs, English second language. Teachers are having a very hard time. Students are having a very hard time. In turn, parents are having a very hard time. Yes, maybe it was a success, and it is success in certain pockets, but that's not what's happening across this state. And so what we're doing is the ones who are having success and everything's going great, guess where they're going? If Common Core is so good and they're going to go up, what's going to happen to the rest of our kids? Where's this gap going to come? Who are you going to blame this on? You going to blame this on the kids because they're poor, the teachers because they don't know how to do it, or are we going to blame it on the rollout from the Department of Ed?
May I address the issue? Our Common Core initiative that's 4.5 years into implementation, we've been on 124 campuses all across the state. It includes school districts like Maynard that has less than 350 students to Mountain Home. These are school districts and school campuses that volunteered to be part of the initiative. Mm-hmm. They made a choice. And so in some ways, they were early adopters. But geographically and in terms of demographics, we've looked at the evenness of the implementation across small and larger school districts. I do think that implementation in general across the state is not necessarily represented in our 124 schools, because we had monthly professional development for the first year and a half and intensive summer institutes. And so they don't represent all the other districts in the state. But we did a general invite to any teacher who could take the survey. So we do believe the survey data is pretty representative.
I was just trying to, at the last minute, look up some things that I wanted to share with you on that note. And I can get them to you when I get back in front of my computer. But when you talk about achievement gap, that's become a real significant issue on the East Coast. In New York, when they did their park test, they found that they had an over 70% failure rate, particularly in the math, and nearly all of the African-American children bombed the test. So when you're talking about minorities, when you're talking about people in poverty, I think from what we're seeing in states that are ahead of us, we can expect our achievement gap to get significantly wider. On a second note, there's a study that you might, and I'll see if I can get my hands on it for you. Representative Randy Alexander worked with a professor or two at the University of Arkansas when we were in the very early stages of Common Core implementation, and they surveyed teachers. I don't remember how many were in there, but one of the takeaways when I was discussing the results with him was the favorability of Common Core among teachers varied depending on where they were in the state and the size of their district. So the teachers who were working in very small rural school districts were much happier and having an easier time with Common Core implementation because they felt like they had more control over what was happening in their classroom and the choosing of materials and that kind of thing. Whereas the teachers who worked in very large school districts who have in place a curriculum coordinator, that's kind of this middle management position, were very unhappy because everything was being arranged and dictated by this curriculum coordinator and then handed to them. So that's just another facet of that conversation, and I can put you in touch with Randy so you can get more information about that.
And if I could do a follow-up, Con, you know, we have tracked with our 124 schools, is their academic achievement increasing or decreasing? And of course, we were teaching the Common Core but assessing in a different manner, and I know you've already discussed that. We look forward to the opportunity of having assessment results aligned to the Common Core, but there are some indicators we can point to, and the indicator I would point out, we just recently did an examination of the schools participating in our Common Core initiative, and their average score on the A through F grading scale was a B. And basically what we did, we took each of their individual scores and divided it by the number of schools. And so there are some quality control indicators we can look at. One of the particular schools in the northwest part of the state, which is a small rural district of about 1,100, when they began working with us the year before, they were in year 7 school improvement. And their scores on the report card, they are not on any level of school improvement now, and their scores were B's. So there is some data we can point to about implementation. I think the conversation about the gap and the achievement gap is something that, you know, we're all going to be examining, because I know in the testimony you received on the first day, we all acknowledge that because the assessment is different, we're probably going to have a dip of achievement. We're very interested in how deep is that dip for these schools who have had a professional development focus on Common Core.
Let me just say this. We are not going to have a break, so get up as you need to get up. I'm about to. And let's just keep on rolling. We're going to go, I know this is not ideal, but we're going to go for about 20 more minutes. So that means succinct will help us. I'm not cutting anybody off. We've had, but if you will self-regulate, then we can go a little faster. Jonathan, while I step out for a second, is going to be the chair. So let's just, you're done? Okay. We're just going to keep on rolling. And when we get to the end, we'll be done and we'll go to the next panel. And that'll be about 3:30. Thank you. Go.
I'm just a little mixed up, so I just need some clarification on a few things. I heard you say earlier about manipulatives that, okay, I'm not sure if you're for or against, or you're for, okay. All right, and then the constructivism was in the United States during the 60s and 70s, bad. That's what we went through. And that, I keep hearing parents say it's not like the math that we were taught, but then you're saying that's the math that we went through.
It's math that's been tried experimentally, scattered. It wasn't mainstreamed for everybody. So some folks experienced it, some didn't. But wherever it was tried, it failed, the constructivist approach.
Was it in California?
Oh, probably. Mr. Werman could probably tell you more about that. And in fact, it's funny you mentioned California, because I was just looking at some of their teacher trainings and they have entire seminars about constructivism now in order to align to Common Core. But yes, I'm certain that's
one of them. Well, I'm a product of multi-state, and I was in California, and then I went to Utah, and then I moved to Texas, and now I'm in Arkansas. But I was in elementary in California, and I'm thinking, well, did I go through this? I'm not sure. So I'm
ask your parents.
But I remember crying. My tears, though, I remember were over long division.
Yes,
those were my tears. So, yeah. I'm just trying to clarify the whole thing. Yeah. So, all three of you agree that Common Core state standards are copyright material.
Yes.
Under that we don't own, that there's some MOU memorandum. Mm-hmm. All three of you agree on that.
I can get you a copy of that MOU. It's on our website.
Okay.
I don't have an opinion. I'm not sure. I understand the way they were developed. I'm sure that the copyright, my reading with the National Governors Association is that the copyright is shared with the state. I'm unsure about the procedure of how we could withdraw if we decide
okay.
to.
All right. And what about, you don't, okay. I'm just trying to clarify things. I'm not sure or unsure.
We have the documents we can send you. And again, the Federal Register. I'll get you guys a copy of that. When you read the Federal Register, you'll see the language regarding the 15% rule and the copyright infringement.
Okay. And one more question for you. I was wondering, I notice you're talking about other people in other states. And are you part of a bigger organization? Or, okay. So about how many parents in Arkansas do you represent?
That sounds like a constructivist math question.
I'm sorry.
I don't know. I can tell you what I do know. I can tell you that our Facebook page has well over 10,000 followers and supporters. I can tell you that there are 12 people on our board, and we have roughly 100 delegates around the state that work to advocate for parents in their district, in their area. The highest attendance we've had at any of our town halls was about 140 people. Mm-hmm. I get phone calls from parents in my own state and around the country probably 3 to 5 a day.
I'm not part of a larger organization. I'm not paid by anybody. I'm just a mom who was very negatively, this is very disruptive to my family. And that caused me to do some research. And when I figured out what it was, I was so disturbed by it that I felt compelled to do something about it and ended up, you know, being offered a book deal and all of that. And it just went from there. So there are plenty of parents, I would argue, and this is just opinion. Don't ask me for a study on this one, because I don't have it. But I would argue that there are more parents in the state that are opposed to Common Core than they are for it.
Okay, because we're interested in what parents, how they feel, and so I'm just trying to get a grasp on how many parents are in your organization, and so that's all. Thank
okay.
you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Ms. Lamoreaux, in terms of one of the things you said earlier during your slides, there was some conversation about the development of the mast. Did you say there were 29 developers of that and five of the, yeah, help me.
Oh, the developing team was much larger than that, but there was a validation committee whose task was to kind of review and sign off on the final draft. Okay. That validation committee had 29 members, five of them refused to sign.
Okay, so less than 20%, let's see how good my math is. Less than 20%.
You need some manipulatives?
Yeah, maybe so.
I'm sure I have something in my purse.
So less than, I guess, 20% of them were opposed to it, mm-hmm. or didn't sign off on it. You know, most of the decisions I might make in my office, I would say if I get 80% buy-in, that's not bad. So why does that bother you so much?
Oh, I just think that we need to listen to what they have to say as well, and I resent the fact that the NGA and the CCSSO went out of their way to kind of sweep that under the rug, and they kept changing the number, and they kept republishing the list so that, you know, you couldn't tell who signed off and who didn't, and it wasn't until all the moms across America put enough pressure on them that they finally were honest about it. So that part bothers me, and it bothers me that the validation committee didn't include early childhood. So at the sign-off stage, there was no early childhood representation, and that concerns me, too.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I've heard it from other people before you. The rub with Bill Gates, the Gates Foundation, you know, I would say it's not a bad model of success, but the emotional backlash when you say that sometimes is...
We're a little bitter.
I would say that's true.
Yeah. We're a little bitter, yeah. I think he's well-intentioned. He's got a lot of money, and he wants to spend it to better education, and I think that's a noble thing. The problem is that the reason why he's doing it is he's investing. It does come out of his nonprofit, but this is very much an investment. He himself calls Common Core a vehicle for creating a market, okay? And the conflict of interest happens when the market succeeds when children fail. So when you have investors like Bill Gates, Rupert Murdoch, who are the guys? I can't think of them all now, but I've got them listed in the book. When these guys are investing money into an education market that profits when kids fail the test, we have a problem. Those tests are built with a 30% failure rate built into them. And what happens when all of a sudden everyone starts passing? Do those guys just go away? Do they stop making money? There's a lot to that that would take a whole nother 8-hour panel. Once you start following the money trail and you see what the intentions are as a parent, it's disturbing and it makes me angry. And I just wish Bill Gates would mind his own business, frankly. So it's one of those things that, you know, Arkansas is going to do what it wants to do with education, whether or not Bill Gates has a hand in it or not. But I also think it's important that when you read studies from Harvard or the National Science Foundation or Vanderbilt, you should know that those studies were paid for and underwritten by Bill Gates for the purpose of supporting Common Core. It's like any other political venture. If you have a case you want to make, you want legislation passed, what do? You go to the universities and you get them to write papers in support of your mission, and then you go open up a 501c3 and a 501c4, and you raise money based on that research, and you go get your legislation passed. They're doing the same thing, and that's what Barbara referred to earlier. You know, you're going to find research on both sides of the issue.
You're going to find research from Pioneer Institute and American Principles Project, which is dedicated to stopping Common Core, and you're going to find research from these other aforementioned groups that's dedicated to keeping Common Core. So it's always important to know who is talking and who they're being paid by. I'm not paid by anybody. I'm a mom.
And since my name was mentioned, I thought I'd weigh in. I believe the philanthropic approach to supporting education often fuels and funds educational initiatives because there are not public tax dollars to do that. And I find it, because I used to be a program officer at a private foundation, I find it ethically unreasonable to think that higher education professors would sell their expertise for a grant. And that's my opinion on that subject.
I think it's a slippery slope when you start jumping to basing the results on who the funders are, but that's my personal opinion. I'm done.
Thank you. Gary?
I don't think I have any questions.
Jacob?
Okay, Ms. Lamoreaux, my question's for you. We talk about whenever we get to seventh grade that the children are at least two grade levels behind, but even looking back, we want to lessen those standards on them, and that just conceptually, that doesn't make sense to me really at all. I mean, the reason for Common Core is to make those standards harder to get us back up to that international competitiveness.
Okay, so you've got it. When you look at the old Arkansas frameworks or you look at the former California or Massachusetts state standards for math prior to Common Core, what you will find is that those proficiencies and fluencies for addition and subtraction, multiplication and division were at one grade level, and they were moved up. So what we used to have to accomplish in third grade, they now don't have to do until fourth grade. What they had to do in fourth grade, they now don't have to do until fifth grade. To me, that's not making it harder, right? You're waiting longer in order for them to master some of those specific proficiencies. And then you're also getting into this argument of, well, you know, are you opposed to harder standards? Of course not. I want my kids challenged. I want my kids competitive. I want my kids to have rigorous standards. God, if I hear the word rigorous one more time, you're going to have to put an emesis bin right here if I hear rigorous one more time. There's a difference, like the Lieutenant Governor said earlier, between being hard and being developmentally inappropriate. I can challenge a student, right, as a teacher. I can give them something that's challenging and push them to perform at a higher grade level. But pushing them to perform in a way that they're not wired developmentally to function is a different thing. So there's two things happening there. You've got the cognitive appropriate issues that come along with constructivism that are built in there, but then you've got the rearranging of the scaffolding that moves everything around and makes it that, in my mind, is less rigorous. In other words, they're spending more time on constructivism and pushing the concrete operations further up the chain. That's what they've done. And to me, that's not rigorous. It's just cognitively inappropriate.
Can I correct one of our inaccuracies?
Yeah, this is what I was about to ask you. What are the other two panelists' opinions on constructivism and the younger grade?
I want to address her statement of how we've moved this a focus standard. Our Arkansas standards from 2004 said NO 2.2.5 demonstrate various meanings of addition and subtraction, and then 2.2.6 demonstrate various addition and subtraction relationships. It's almost exactly what it says in Common Core for second grade, and so we've not moved them. I mean, they are exactly where they were. The differences between Common Core and what Arkansas had originally are very few. I mean, we took money out. We don't ask our kindergartners to tell time anymore. I mean, there are some things like that that have changed, but for the most part, our focus standards have stayed the same. We are expecting the same thing from our children that we expected earlier. These are just written with better pedagogy.
The assertion of 1 to 2 years behind comes from the American Principles Project and their report, so I would refer you to that.
I believe the Common Core state standards are more rigorous, and I base that on the teachers and their feedback on how what is expected of students and how they have changed their classroom practices have made those individual students have a more rigorous opportunity to learn.
Just a clarification that when I referred to the 2 years behind, that's what Mr. Borman and Dr. Milgram of Stanford was talking about, referring to Common Core standards vis-a-vis the international achieving standards. That was my point. And so I don't know which 2 year you were referring to. The other thing is my point that I made earlier is I think we can put to bed any issue of where we are versus where we were. That's not the question. The question is where should we be? Okay.
I passed a while ago, and I would like.
Oh, okay.
Like to back up.
Check with him. He's in charge. Are you still going? No, I mean Jacob. Oh, Jacob's done.
I'm sorry, I thought you were through.
Luke, are you?
The reason I didn't ask this question is it's going to sound kind of stupid, but I don't think it's that stupid a question. We've heard the word rigor 5 million times in the last 2 weeks. I've heard it before that, and I wanted to ask the question, what makes a standard rigorous? We keep saying, how do we know one's rigorous and one isn't? How bad does a standard have to be to not be rigorous? How good does it have to be rigorous? I mean, that surely there's a rubric something that we judge the standard by.
The two-year rigor deal was not rigor in the abstract. It was rigor, Dr. Milgram, comparing Common Core to international expectations. So in that case, he said they are less rigorous. So that's a comparison. But I don't know what context you're referring it.
I'm talking about, I've said myself, I believe in rigorous standards. I want a rigorous standard, but there has to be a definition of what that standard includes for it to be rigorous.
Well, if you're number one,
I know it sounds like a stupid question, and maybe it is. I don't know, but I've used that term myself, and I really hadn't thought about what I was saying, I guess. I sound like an idiot.
Okay, I'll take a shot at it. It isn't a silly question. I think that it's part of a comparative approach where you look at past standards and current standards and what are the outcomes that students, what do students know and are able to do based on the standards, and then there is a value judgment if the new standards have led to higher levels of learning. And I'm not sure there's ever a rubric around it, but it's usually used in terms of comparison.
Okay.
And I think the people who would be the best to have that conversation are the people who live with the standards every day, and those are classroom teachers and school individuals.
Probably. Have you read the Fordham Institute's where they graded the standards in 2010? Have you compared the grades to the next set of NAEP scores? Is there a correlation between the grades the standards got and the scores that states got on their NAEP test?
I'm unaware if there was, but it certainly is an interesting question that we should examine.
Okay.
I also think that when those individual scores of the standards came out, each state had some pushback about whether they felt that was a valid measure or not. But I believe in Arkansas, most educators thought it was a pretty appropriate measure.
We would have thought that if the Fordham Institute rated standards for a state rigorous, those rigorous standards should have been reflected in high NAEP scores, wouldn't you think?
The only thing is implementation of the standards There's not an immediate gain in academic achievement necessarily. And that, I think, is part of the entire discussion about having some time to examine how the standards have changed the outcomes.
And isn't it true there's also 100 other variables?
Absolutely.
Income, teacher quality, neighborhood,
reading level.
Parents, what are the parents even know where their kids
educational
are, that
educational level
right.
of parents.
Educational level. I mean, there's so many factors other than that, and that's probably part of it, too. We need to, Luke.
I'm ready.
Okay.
I wanted to talk about international expectations. We keep talking about standards compared across countries. And I want to make an analogy that I think we're trying to restore an old car that's not working very well. And the car is education in Arkansas, where we are 48th in the nation on college graduation rates. So our car is not running really well. And I think we're debating what octane of gas to put in it. No doubt, the car can't run without gasoline. And it has to have a certain minimum octane. And the higher the octane, the better. Great, let's raise the octane of the gasoline. But there's a wheel missing, and there's a leak in the radiator, and there's pistons misfiring. And when I talk with parents, nobody complains about the standards. Nobody complains about the expectations. They want more help. Our schools are 90% free and reduced. They want more resources. And we already have a longer school day. We go till 4 o'clock, we go 2 weeks in the summer. We take our kids on field lessons on Saturdays throughout each month. But there's so much to this other than the standards. We look at the spending across states. We keep talking about Massachusetts. The census data from last year says 2012, Arkansas spent $9,400. Massachusetts spent $14,000. New York spending $19,000. We can look at rural states. Wyoming spending $15,000 per child. Alaska spending $17,000 per child. And so if we're really trying to improve education in Arkansas, is the debate over whether Common Core standards are good enough and whether we need to include 11 and 12 as fluency facts in second grade really the obstacle to what we're trying to do here? And I don't know what the purview of this panel is. And I don't know if we could argue that, hey, there's bigger things for us to be concerned about right now than when does 11 and 12 get mastered as fluency facts. So my question, other than standards, if we can make a recommendation about what needs to improve in education in Arkansas, what would we recommend?
First of all, I agree with you that standards are not the panacea of education improvement that the Common Core players are claiming they will be. Secondly, with regard to spending, I don't think that throwing more money at a problem is going to solve it either. We've got data from the United States Department of Education that shows that we have increased the money that we're throwing at education from the 1970s to now by over 300%. And all of our test scores are flatlined. They're not reading better. They're not doing math any better. We are constantly spending, throwing more money, and not getting the results that we want from it. I think the other thing to consider when you compare Arkansas spending $9,000 a student in a state like New York spending 14 is that the cost of living up there is significantly higher. 14 grand there is not the same as 14 grand here. Having said all of that, and I want to correct the whole 11 and 12 thing because that was misrepresented. My point was that the Common Core standards do not mandate that our students learn to rotely multiply all of those factors. They only have to pick two by the end of third grade. It's not just the 11 and 12. That was completely misrepresented. That aside, I think the answer to solving education at the end of the day has to be addressed outside of education. I think the only way that we're going to see improvements and better performance is if we address poverty, if we address access to good schools, and give parents as much choice and liberty and direction in the education of their children as possible. You can have the best standards in the world, you can have the best standardized test, you can have the best teachers, but as long as you have children in your school that are living in poverty and don't have the resources that they need to succeed, they won't. So I think the answer lies outside of ed.
Mary or Barbara?
I personally think that we need to establish a standard operating procedure that education is personalized to the learner. And that means a lot of different things. It means changes of policy, but it means that students are at the focus of the educational program. And appropriate support services to empower that student as a learner would be something that could be a very powerful intervention that could change the school systems.
And I would agree with Barbara on that. If we're going to have to meet our kids where they are, you know, we've got children that go home and they don't get fed maybe one meal a day all summer, and we know that. And you know, it's hard to teach a child that's hungry, but we still have to support our teachers and let them have the materials that they need. So, you know, looking at funding is an important thing. So I think if there was anything I could change, it would be that we make sure that our teachers receive the training they need to help them deal with their students at the level where those children are coming in, and that they know how to move those children on to be much more successful. You know, I had a principal that I dearly loved that she said the most important thing you can say to your children when they come in is, when you go to college, that we have that expectation that our kids are going to go somewhere. And that's the training, you know, and we've got that poverty training that a lot of our schools are going through, and we just need to make that work for our teachers.
Thank you. Jason was telling me he's going to pass for now. Is that what you said? Oh, you're fast. Oh. All right. I would point out that school funding is not the focus of this panel, and I'll walk you through what you can certainly write the governor about anything. The reason we're so focused on Common Core is because that's Common Core and testing and the data privacy is our main focus, but we certainly can put a plug in for anything.
And I'm not advocating that. You look at Poland, that does much better than the United States. Their poverty is a much worse poverty. They have more students under poverty, in poverty. But there's a lot of things different in their education.
That's
they
right.
don't have sports. They care about the academics. When we look at our districts, what is the breakout of how we fund and care about athletics versus how we care and look at academics? And I think those are some of the things we need to consider if that's really what we're focused on improving. I'll be quiet.
But I have 26 days of school left, and I can't say that.
He just did. Jason, very, very fast, Jason. I'm just saying.
The lieutenant governor took about 25 hours. And then he tells me to
You can take 25. You'll probably be here alone.
Real quick on this right here, those issues with the academics and things outside, those aren't Common Core issues. My question is for Ms. Karen. Ms. Karen, you wanted to take out the creativity, the drawing and all those things at the lower levels, yes?
Who said I wanted to take out creativity? Oh, no, that's not what I said.
Okay, well.
Yeah, I'm all for liberal arts education, and even with regard to what he said, I think it's important to have a well-rounded education that includes sports and the arts and all of those things. That
right.
Years ago in America, educating a student meant creating an individualized, well-rounded, free-thinking citizenry, and top-down standardization is the antithesis of that. I'm certainly not opposed to creativity. They can get that in art class or literature or wherever.
The issue with the drawings is that it's as far as the parents are concerned, and according to the tenets of constructivism, that is not appropriate for that grade. In the fourth grade, my child should not be making little drawings and writing down hash marks in groups of 50 and 100 to solve a problem that he could do using standard algorithm in two steps. Instead, they're asking them to draw it on paper with 108 steps, and to me, that's not efficient and completely unnecessary.
Real quick, one more. I, too, am a father first, and I'm an educator, and maybe you can help me with this. I have that gap. I have a sixth grader, and I have a first grader. And my first grader, I was looking at some of the standards here in first grade, and it talked about making sense of problems and reasoning abstractly and constructing arguments and so forth and so on. So my wife promised my first grader $50 if he read 36 books. And then he decided he wanted a game, and the game cost $20. And so my wife said, hey, if you read 36 books, you get $20. And my first grader said, no, Mom, wait a minute. If you give me $50 and the book only costs $20, I got 30 extra dollars. And so I'd rather you just pay me for the 36 books, the $50, and then I get the extra $30. Now, that's a cute little story, but then when I start to ask myself, could my sixth grader had reasoned through all of those things when he was in the first grade? And my sixth grader is smart. I mean, he's straight A's also. I don't know if he would have had that ability in the first grade to rationalize through that whole deal without having been exposed to some of the things he was exposed to in kindergarten and first grade to this point. So I don't know about the developmental level or if it's appropriate or not, but I think we got to be careful when we only want to teach to, I don't want to say the middle or the lower. We also have to consider those kids in that classroom that can say, wait a minute, Mom, if you give me $50 and I only got to spend 20, then I get to keep 30. But thank you for your passion. I enjoy your passion. I'm a passionate person myself. Thank all the panel. Thank you, Lieutenant Governor, for letting me have my say.
I agree with you that our kids should be given all of those tools. It's like I said before, as parents, the argument for us is don't only give them one and mandate one, and that's what the standards are doing. They're mandating certain approaches, and the test mandates certain approaches. We want our kids to get all the tools in the toolbox. Different approaches will work for different children. It's not for us to say whether or not the abstract approach worked for your son or the standard algorithm approach worked for him. Whatever works for him, great. We just don't want mandating one thing.
Thank you all. Thank you, Barbara Hunter Cox. Thank you, Karen Lamoreaux. Thank you, Mary Armstrong. Appreciate it very, very much. And we're not going to take a break unless if you want to take a break, get up and take a break. We're just going to keep on rolling.